Well, I just wanted to say thank you so much for talking to me.
I have a gift.
I've been following your work for many, many years. I started reading your column in Scientific American before I was 10 years old.
Cool.
The Axemaker's Gift, the Connection series, The Day the Universe Changed. And I've shown them to friends and partners of mine. There are quite a few people with whom and what in your comfortable urban life has ever prepared you for that decision is an inside joke.
Yes.
And strangely enough, in 2003, I was in Manhattan when that big blackout began.
Oh yeah, good. That was fun.
It felt like getting dropped into the narrative, except that I saw a bunch of corporate lawyers pulling the sofas from their building lobbies out on the sidewalk to drink beer. And saw people, good Samaritans, directing traffic in every intersection, while twice as many people were making documentaries of the people directing traffic.
Right, I'll bet.
And then fireflies in Central Park.
Yeah, well, that was something.
Just to give you a bit of an introduction to me, I've always been a severe insomniac. And when I was a child, the only thing that it was possible to do.
Okay,
There you go.
we are recording. Mila?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah, we're recording.
Okay, great. So, by the time I was applying to university, they stream people very aggressively based on mathematical skill. So I could get a full scholarship in the arts, but not in the sciences. So my focus has been on environmental politics. So as
Yes,
an
I know. Yes.
undergraduate, okay. Well, by the
Yes, and
time I was doing,
you
I'm
got your
sorry.
doctorate last year.
In December, yes.
Right, yeah.
But really, since 2007, since as an MPhil student, I read Ali's The 2 Mile Time Machine, I've been
Yeah.
focused on climate change and the severity of the threat that it seems to pose to human beings. So that's one of the
Right.
main questions I want to ask you about.
Oh.
I did also have a few projects that are somewhat inspired by your work.
Oh dear.
I set up a honeypot web server that's meant to attract web scraping bots and see what it does with the results. It's a kind of cabinet of curiosities for data scrapers.
Yes.
I'm working on a Sherlock Holmes novel, which is about Isambard Kingdom Brunel and the Great Eastern and the laying of the transatlantic submarine cable, an
Good
attempt
stuff.
to sabotage that. And I
Yes.
recently had an AI short story about AIs claiming sentience and trying to mediate relations between human beings and other intelligent creatures. But looking at your methods, starting with storytelling, one of the things I loved in the new episodes was in episode 6466, going from X-ray crystallography to the structure of DNA to the importance of selective breeding in human history. It was also really great to see kind of the reprise of the Apollo Thermos famous monologue, except with the R7 and with kerosene in the first
Oh,
stage.
God, that one. Oh, yes.
I'd say one of the great virtues of knowing about science is being able to apply the central concepts to any new problem, like conservation of mass, conservation of energy. Even if you don't know anything about the new idea or situation being presented to you, you can kind of work from first principles in that way. So what I wanted to ask is, has anything dramatically changed in your approach to teaching and storytelling since the first connections in the late 70s?
Well, yes. I mean, above all, the change in the media, well, or medium really, of television and radio. When I began in the Stone Age, there was no such thing as a shortage of money. If they liked your idea, they just said how much, and you named a wild budget figure, and they said fine, and that was the end of that. Then you had to spend it, and if you thought you spent it badly, you'd never get any more. So there was a certain amount of curative ability you needed. The other thing that made major difference is because of that availability of funding, it was easy to take a big film crew with lights around the world and point them all at, sandfully on the shore of a foreign beach. and discuss the spots on the back of the sand flea. You can't do that anymore. There isn't the money. So, and also back then, that the ease with which you could get budget funding meant that massive projects. I mean, at one end of the scale, I began with a show on why the Leaning Tower of Pisa doesn't fall over. And the other end of the scale at the same time was a short program of 13 hours called Civilization, and another one called A Life on Earth. So, you know, there was a very wide range of stuff going on. And all you had to do is to put a finger in the wind and say, can I have this much? And you've got it. Now you can't do that. Documentary films are falling off like autumn leaves. I think I'm right in saying the BBC only runs one channel with any documentaries on it, whereas once upon a time, every channel had documentaries. And that, and of course, the world of documentary type material is now shifting more and more away from television to channels on to online, and the technology that makes it possible now for almost anybody who wants to make their own documentary or an equivalent and put it out online and have scads of people see it. I'm sure your work does the same thing. So that's changing. That is still changing a great deal, but it's certainly very different from when I began.
Have people's minds changed in ways that alter how they can be taught?
Well, I'm, you know, I don't spend time in a classroom, so I can't give you chapter and verse on that. But I get the impression that material can go out much faster than it used to. I mean, I was thinking the other day about one of the programs in this recent series I did. The material, there's about three times the material in the same 1 hour that there used to be when I started on Connections years ago. So in a sense, I think the audience is a much more sophisticated one than it ever was before. It is less easily impressed. It's harder to cheat and lie to it. It has too many backup sources to check on anything you tell it. So you have to be a bit careful about saying whatever you say. Good thing, I think.
Mm. You mentioned on-location scenes and recreations, which were very much a memorable part of the earlier series. Yes. I remember things like British soldiers demonstrating the Pike Square or recreations of the Champagne Fairs.
Yes.
Is there anything you can share about what that travel was like? And what was your research and writing process? Did you figure out everything in the library and then go out around the world to get these?
Yes. Yes to both. I mean, basically, research was library book research for a long time. I mean, research for a 10-part series would take at least a year and a half before you went anywhere. And you'd sit in the library and you'd put stories together, and then you'd check the story details and find out that you were wrong or you were half right. So a lot of checking and double checking went on to make certain that the minute you opened your mouth on screen, you wouldn't have 100 experts destroying you. Yes, sorry. What was the second half of first half of your question?
Was there anything from that travel that
remember? Well, not really. You know, making films is just a lot of hard work. The exciting stuff is the research and the work in production before you leave the building. And that was really quite good. I mean, we enjoyed thinking about how we would illustrate something and then finding out how it would be possible to do it and then finding out if we could afford to and then going to do it. The doing was really mostly a very, very expert film crew turning your half-baked ideas into something that looked good.
And what about the virtual sets in this new series? Was that a practical accommodation or a deliberate choice? And how did it affect how you presented the material?
Yeah, it was faute de mieux. We, you know, much, much, much less money than ever before. And the question was, what could we afford to do? Well, we couldn't afford to go anywhere. I mean, shipping a film crew around the world is an extremely expensive business. Never mind what they drink and eat. And so it really boiled down to standing in front of a camera and telling as good a story as you could and using as clever backup material as you could. from virtual reality, a bit of that, quite a lot of archive film material. And and when you have that limitation, you have to tell the story in a different way. So I sort of have always felt that this series isn't really television. It's more radio with pictures on it. And I don't know whether we'll ever go back to what I would call television, because I don't know if there's ever going to be the money again to do it until some very clever people start doing it themselves on online, and then we'll find out.
On the broad topic of contingency in history, it seems like one of your consistent themes is that work gets done that could have changed the world, but it simply gets ignored or forgotten. Is there any plausible way, either at the individual level or the societal level, we could avoid that kind of lost in the drawer effect?
Well,
is
I'm
it
not
getting
sure.
Harder when our whole society is kind of focused on blockbusters? Everybody watches Barbie and Oppenheimer, but not the long tail of other things.
Well, this is partly why I structured this last series the way I did, to try in a rather lame way to say, these are the ways that change happens. Keep your eye out for stuff like this happening near you. So to a certain extent, the series was a bit of a vade-mecum about how you learn to predict. And I think that's probably all that is to be said. You know, the human brain is a massive, massive instrument. And the trick is learning to use it better than we usually do, and certainly better than we are taught to at school. And what I was doing in a very small way with this series is saying, here are some tools that you can use, the way to look around and see what is likely to bring change, what is likely to make something outmoded before you get to use it, and is that the direction you should be heading in, that sort of idea.
It seemed to me like the episode about the quantum computer was kind of the biggest contradiction in your body of work. Because if the focus is on contingency and how one unpredictable thing causes a consequence nobody could have expected, does it follow that if we had a quantum computer large enough to simulate all the particles in the universe, we would know what the future would be? Or would we just be able to run projections? Or like, is there a difference between running simulations, predicting, and forecasting?
I would have thought that the end aim of artificial intelligence was to produce a system that would allow you to run the material as you've just described, and that prediction without the use of artificial intelligence is just guesswork. If you have, I think, artificial intelligence on a large enough scale with enough power, you can run all the alternatives it can think of, which is many more than I can or you can, or all of us can, faster than any of us, and therefore generate a future on a scale and in the kind of detail that none of us can. I mean, this is why I think artificial intelligence is going to change everything. So, yeah, that's my answer.
But if literally a single high energy particle can cause a break in a DNA strand that causes someone who would have been historically important to die of a tumor instead, just being able to simulate a universe's worth of particles can't necessarily tell you about that rare event. You know, who's going to get that high energy particle at what time?
I don't see why not. I mean, it depends on how powerful your artificial intelligence predictives are. I mean, the question is, could you predict the motion of every particle in the universe? If you could, you would. And you would know which person was going to get it and which wasn't, this dangerous particle. And I don't see why there's any reason why we should not be able to do that at one point. Not tomorrow, not in 10 years. But I think in 25 years, we're going to start thinking on that scale.
But that assumes that the universe is deterministic at its root, that all you need is the information and the laws
What else is there?
Well, isn't it central to the quantum universe that there are multiple possibilities? There's this ever-branching universe tree that you could have gone down this branch or you could have gone down that branch?
Sure, of course. That's what I try to do. That's why I built this thing called a knowledge web. What a pompous thing to build, to call it, in which I've over the years, have produced a kind of network, very, 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 very small, 20,000 people linked 30,000 ways. But you can go down many, many branching ways in that. I see no reason why there should be a limit on being able to do that. No, not tomorrow, of course.
Okay. Well, in practical terms, recognizing that big discoveries, big ideas, big inventions have unpredictable consequences that their initiators didn't intend or expect.
Yes.
What does that unpredictability imply for efforts at deliberately creating change?
Today and earlier in history, tough luck. You know, good luck to you if you think you're going to do something and it's going to turn out to be exactly what you wanted to happen. As I say, I think over the next 20 years, we will learn to find ways of dealing with that problem. I mean, life is going to become, I think, extremely different. Even the smallest amount of advance in terms of the certainty with which we'll be able to predict.
Okay. Moving on to another theme.
Yes.
Corporate utopianism. What would you say the history of planned corporate settlements implies for their potential future on the moon, on Mars, and the rest of the solar system? What happens when your employer literally owns everything you need to survive for the next minute?
Yeah, I don't understand your question. What does it mean to you when your employer...
They own the air, they own the pressure vessel that's keeping you alive.
Yeah, in a spacecraft.
Yeah, or a moon colony, Mars colony, or asteroid.
Well, that's still a tiny amount of stuff to own. So it's not something I would extrapolate to society at large. I don't think so.
I just mean that the level of corporate control in a space colony would exceed what any prior corporate utopian was able to do, because you literally could not survive without the infrastructure that you're embedded in.
That's true every time you fly in an airplane or many other aspects of technology that you use to do something in life and that there are no alternatives but to use that. And if I want to come and see you in Canada, I'm going to fly. And there are all kinds of things relating to fly that are the same kind of thing you're discussing. So it doesn't bother me that there is kind of utopian, there's corporate control over what I breathe when I'm on the moon. As long as I breathe, I don't care, as long as I get back. And presumably the little I had to do with Apollo 11 when I covered it, you know, the stuff you give those guys is exactly what they need. No point giving them any excess because it's weight and or less. And if I go to the moon and I get provided with exactly what I need to do what I have to do, presumably this has been discussed before we left. Otherwise, what's a flight plan for? So there are limitations required by the event itself, which limit what the corporate involvement might be. I guess
I'm thinking about a colony that exists that intends to keep operating, that people don't come back from.
Life support system is what you're talking about, really, because all other things are irrelevant. I mean, without a valuable life support system, the colony wouldn't exist. I'm sorry, I don't really understand the question. Try me again.
Like, if you are part of a corporate venture that goes to Brazil or Africa, you can leave and go survive. There are other societies.
Yes.
You can go home. Yes. I guess it's if we don't get high-speed travel technology. So the only way to get out into the solar system is a multi-month, multi-year journey that probably can't be reversed. The people who end up out there, yes, instead of being governed by a political system, and instead of having some kind of choice about an alternative arrangement, if you're born on SpaceX's Mars colony, and the only alternative is out the airlock or follow the colony's rules.
Yes.
I'm kind of asking whether that sort of a vision for life off the planet is likely, given who has these resources and these ambitions. And is there anything that the past efforts, you know, New Harmony or the Port Sunshine, could tell people, could inform us about, you know, how should we be regulating those kinds of efforts? What should people considering going think through?
Well, Port Sunlight and New Harmony, I mean, New Harmony failed because it was run, they argued all the time about who did what. Port Sunlight didn't fail, but it didn't achieve very much. I mean, it kept those people alive in little houses looking as if they were, you know, Shakespeare. Weren't there many Shakespeare houses? I don't understand why this is a problem, in the sense that if we go to Mars, there are a number of rules that you have to agree to before you go. And there is also the possibility that there might be unforeseen problems that require unusual reactions, and you have to agree to deal with those problems as they occur in the predicted way, best you can do. If you agree to all that, then you're there. As for leaving the solar system, I think it's a pointless discussion, in the sense that what's the nearest planet? 17,000 light years away? Too far. And the universe is, I mean, it's just a joke. It's so big.
Okay. So jumping to a different theme.
Yes, give up on that one.
What explains our collective lack of judgment about holy books? It would seem to me like two tests you would apply to work out whether something was divinely inspired. Does it include anything that the society that created it doesn't know that turns out to be true? And does it include things that are untrue that the society that created it believed? And when you apply those tests, it seems hard to believe in any holy book. And yet, so much of the global population is confident that they contain all the answers, even though they were written in a world that utterly ceased to exist.
I think if you have virtually no tools to handle the problems of life, you tend to rely on some other source of help. And that source of help is usually a superior source, like God up in the sky. If you don't have the belief of such an entity existing, you're on your own. And there must have been many Stone Age tribes who managed all right. I'm an atheist myself, so I don't. Your question has no meaning for me. I mean, holy book, schmuck, I believe is the word one should say, Canadian. it seems to me belief in the supernatural can only end up generating trouble, because the supernatural can do anything. And if you want to do anything, you say, I can do anything, or I believe in anything. Imagined. And any time that imagined belief is used to run society in any way, it can do nothing but cause trouble, eventually, seems to me. But call me
if the purpose of holy books is to deal with that deficit you were mentioning, people who don't have a scientific understanding of the world, how do we deal with the fact that they're more important than ever to many people? We've got religious nationalist governments in numerous countries, but you know, there's a risk of a Christian nationalist government in the United States. So it's not lack of scientific understanding that's causing people to emphasize those explanations.
No, I didn't say it was. I think those explanations are very good ways of conning a large number of people into giving you power. Full stop, period.
And is there a counter to that?
Yes. Quit. I mean, why would you believe in some winged person in the sky? For goodness sake. You know, I know we're going to offend somebody to death if they ever see this this interview you're doing, but that's too bad. I mean, I just, you know, fairyland.
Something like 90, 95% of people say that they have some sort of immortal being or soul. To me, I find that one of the most alienating facts about humanity. Walking around with all these people who have a radically different sense of what the nature of consciousness is.
Yep. I couldn't agree more.
And yet we need to function and make plans in a world where for so many people that is the crucial narrative and explanation of why the universe is how it is.
That may be true, but on the other hand, you know, if the drains are dirty, you clean them. You know, and it seems to me that we're clogged up with all this stuff. And it does nothing but, yes, of course it does good. I mean, there are many, many, many good things done by religious people all over the planet. But such people do it because they choose to, because whether or not they need religion to give them the impetus to help their fellow man, I would question. If you took their religion away, would they suddenly turn into monsters? I doubt it.
Is empiricism and the study of history now threatened by the ease with which false material can be fabricated? Like one historical example I've often thought of is the Vela incident in 1979, where as an amateur historian trying to figure out what happened, there are sufficiently capable governments with a sufficient motivation to produce false material that if you don't have access to those insider accounts, it's kind of become impossible for an average person to understand what happened there. But it seems like now that capability to falsify is being drastically democratized. Was there just a short period of time where videos and photos existed and were considered credible proof of something? And now we're getting into an era where forever that's not going to be the case again?
Yes, I do. But I question the second part of your statement. I think that the what we call, you know, the instruments of falsification these days, growing every day, could also be seen as growing every day, the possibility of more imaginative ways of looking at the world. So I don't think it's all bad at all. And the thing about falsifying data is that it's there to be checked. The marvelous thing about using the same techniques to produce imaginative work, there's nothing there to check. And that's why that's what is so exciting about the imagination. I mean, if I choose to invent a society in which everyone can fly in the sky and then tell stories about them, that's falsification, if you like, but it's also an imaginative way of looking at the human condition and allows one imaginative ways of looking at alternatives to the way we behave, that sort of thing. So there's two sides to that question.
In terms of this kind of broader point about the pace of social and technological change versus kind of the development of the human mind or human societies, one example that's often struck me, for the huge majority of human history, of course, you lived in a village where you knew everybody else. Now we're in this era where most people living in cities don't know their neighbors, but we're at the very brink of the era where any person who you happen to see, you're going to be able to identify them. The clerk who does a bad job with your fast food order, you can be on their social media page saying what a dummy they are within two seconds.
Yes.
I guess, do you have any insights about what that first lurch from living in groups where we knew each other to the atomized society has done? And if modern alienation comes in part from living alone or in small groups, what happens when that anonymity ends because you can identify anybody?
Yes, you're approaching this as if it were a negative, a problematic issue. I see it the other way around, that moving from the medieval I live in my village or I live in my cottage to living in the middle of downtown New York offers a colossal opportunity to know things and people of enormous benefit to you as a person who's developing. So I think the positive side is much more valuable than the potential to make life more difficult for people who are nervous and like being alone. Okay, I think, yes.
I guess what I was asking about is more the emotional or sociological consequences on the one hand of not having that inevitable integrated village life, and then what happens when you have this weird technologically driven global village where you know someone because you can look up their Google results rather than you have any recollection about them or shared experiences.
That presupposes you do nothing with the information or that you never meet anybody physically. Walk out of your door and you'll bump into 1,000 people about which you know a great deal more than you ever could have before because of the technology. And from that, with which you can benefit so much more because you understand the ways in which they could provide you the things that you need or could benefit from, and vice versa. So I would argue that you could just as much think about it being an integrative event and not one in which it breaks us apart.
In terms of attention tracking and human-computer interfaces, I had never seen something like the autometer, but it seemed like an unnerving mechanized glimpse into today's eye tracking and sentiment analysis. I was a bit surprised that you didn't get more into that question of the attention economy and thought and emotion tracking. Like, what does it do to people sociologically when they know that they're surrounded by instruments that can guess what they're feeling? Does that create kind of universal chilling effect?
I don't know that it has any more effect than the first time somebody said, this is called a pen, and this is what you do with it in 1492. I mean, you know, these additives to our behavior should also be seen as positive as well as negative. I'm afraid I'm an optimist, because the alternative is to jump out of the window, which doesn't help anybody.
In the hands of authoritarian governments, has technology made it possible for authoritarianism to be complete and impossible to dislodge through internal democratic agitation?
Well, you see, as I said to you just now, I'm an optimist, so I would tend to believe that the effect is the opposite, that you have many more ways of getting in there to stop this authoritarianism from being what it is. So I think we are providing ourselves with greater keys to more doors.
But if we look at something like contemporary China, doesn't it seem like technology has done more to empower the government to control people than to empower individuals to pursue their own chosen life course?
Yeah, but you haven't given them very much time to do this. I would say that, you know, by the time technology is hitting China, China has already got a very, very well-developed centralized authoritarian way of running things. So, you know, you've got to wait to see the effect, and it's not going to happen today or tomorrow, but I would believe it will happen.
Okay. Nuclear weapons have been a consistent topic of interest and endpoint for your chains of connections. In the new episode 6465, you touch upon the danger of accidental or unauthorized use. Do you think people have learned the wrong lesson from the Cold War? How do you think the various dangers associated with nuclear weapons compare?
Difficult question, that. The problem is going to become serious if and when nuclear weapons become cheap enough for more than major government budgets to handle. Because as long as it's in the hands of governments, it's a scale which we more readily understand, and for which we already have tools to deal with. I mean, we have processes that deal with the relationship between us and the government that give us means of getting into their decision-making processes and having something to do with it. What bothers me is the day in which nuclear power, nuclear weapons become cheap enough for anybody to use. And, you know, that's, but then that's always been the case. The same is true of sword making and arrow making and so on. You're right. It's a much, the scale is much worse. I can say nothing except we've got to keep our eyes on it.
I guess what I was asking about lessons is some people look at the history of nuclear weapons and they say that this is a case of a triumph of rationality. They make war too expensive to wage. And so overall, they're a stabilizing effect. But in contrast to that kind of rational analysis, there's this prestige position on nuclear weapons. Like the reason they're so important to North Korea, to Pakistan, arguably is not about their rational real world capabilities, but what they prove about technological capability and great power status. So can proliferation be checked when the motives are this pride and prestige base?
I would have thought that was true of many other aspects of individual governments wanting to express their power or their importance or their view of the world in a way that would not necessarily please everybody else around them. I think, in other words, what I'm saying is that I don't think it's a problem relating solely to nuclear weapons. What you do about it is, that's what governments are for. We, you know, the, just trying to think of a recent example. Gaza. You know, Gaza is a mess at the moment, and the only way out of it is for a number of countries to get together, or maybe the United Nations and an international police force to get together and sort it out. It seems to me that that's what institutions are for. And there is an institution, that no doubt, in government that makes it less dangerous than it used to be to have nuclear weapons lying around, because it's easier to organize and deal with issues than it used to be. That sounds palliative junk. It probably is.
That's I'm being warned that we don't have much time left, so no, I'm no, going to go skip to my last big question.
Yeah,
is there a hidden pedagogy within your work? How do we prepare today's young people for what's coming?
Well, there's a hidden pedagogy in the sense that these little programs are meant to give usually young people a view of the way history works and how change can happen. And to a certain extent, as I said earlier, how you might be able to predict what that change is going to be by using the same kind of technique. And the technique is available to everyone, because how I make these programs is not maybe the way people think. I start in the future and go backwards. And I look in wider circles around each link in order to find the least expected link backwards. And I do that for obvious reasons, to make the audience surprised and keep them watching. And after a number of links, usually something like 12 or 14, because to keep the pace going, you're not going to do more than 2 or 3 minutes on each subject. And so around about link 13 or 14, I'm scouring in all directions for the most unexpected beginning. Thus, for example, as I think I mentioned earlier, the show that ends with predictive analytics begins with Napoleon's toothpick. And they're all a bit like that. Perovskite free energy in the near future is in a program beginning with potatoes in the Inca Empire. So what one is trying to do is to look at a structure, a mechanism that shows some of the ways in which change occurs, and that's the best you could do. Sorry.
Having, I was a TA for 13 different courses during my PhD. And it seems like young people don't always have a great deal of motivation to learn. Is there some way in which awareness of how tough their futures may be could provide that motivation? Is there a way to get that across? You really need to know this stuff?
I think the opposite is true. I think what we need to tell young people is that 20 years from now, there may well be no jobs to have as artificial intelligence takes that area of life over. And that the most important thing they can do is to find out what it is they really like and try to find a way to spend their life doing that and producing what it helps them to produce, if anything. And, you know, there'll be no need to worry about feeding yourself or clothing yourself and so on. Artificial intelligence will provide that. So the thing is, I think the thing that young people would find extremely easy to latch onto is, how would you like to find out about yourself what it is you're really good at? Now go away and spend the next 10 years doing that. And it's got nothing to do with, do you pass an exam in physics? Are you any good at Latin? You know, the stuff, the standards, bog standard stuff that you get at school, because that'll be pointless. I mean, it won't be pointless. It'll be part of what you know and what you are, but it won't be necessary to have any jobs because there won't be any jobs. So I would have thought that the future could look very rosy to young people. There we are.
I guess my final question, personal to me, for someone with my skills determined to help avoid catastrophic climate change, how should they use the rest of their life?
As if I should know. I can't answer except in the ways that I have already. If that's what fills you, use it. I mean, if what gives you purpose in life is to solve the problem of climate change, then all I can tell you is to do nothing but. I mean, there will be aspects of that problem not necessarily directly associated with the weather, but 1,000 other things that secondarily relate. And many of those areas need all the help they can get, all the interest of brains that they can cull to serve whatever problem it is they're dealing with. So there's a ton of stuff to spend the rest of your life doing, not necessarily directly climate change, but associative stuff. Because heaven knows, you know, climate is there everywhere. So it's going to have repercussions everywhere. So one of those places could be where you spend your life. I don't know, because I don't know what it is you would do. Okay. I think I'll run away now.
Well, if you're ever in Toronto, it would be great to check out a library or a museum with you. And thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me.
Great pleasure, Milan. Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, Milan. Goodbye. Thanks, James. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.